every single...
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
The words are often hard to find for avid news appraisers. With election denial, conspiracy theories, and good old Jewish space lasers, repeating the same adjectives feels boring, even lazy. But Southern vernacular has some spectacular ways to say someone's crazy. One chicken leg short of a picnic, one wheel short of a truck, one prawn short of a cocktail, two bits short of a buck, a few crumbs short of a biscuit, a few spokes short of a wheel, or two French fries short of a happy meal. These folks are two cans short of a six-pack, a few bricks short of a hod, a few clowns short of a circus, several peas short of a pod, a few lettuce leaves short of a salad, several frames short of a reel, or just a few fries short of a happy meal. There's lots of ways and turns of phrase to describe nuts and make fun of them. With today's far right, it seems we might need to use every one of them. Because they're all a few sprinkles short of a sundae, a few yards short of the goal, a bunch of pepperoni short of a pizza, a few Fruit Loops short of a bowl, one taco short of a combo plate, a few coughs short of a meal, or two fries short of a happy meal. Oh yeah, they're one neuron short of a synapse, one wall short of a room, a bunch of nuts short of a fruitcake, a few bristles short of a broom, some potato chips short of a tuna casserole, a few cards short of a deal, three fish short of a fry, one toke short of a high, not the sharpest spoon in the drawer, their elevator don't go to the top floor. Yeah, all those guys are two fries short of a happy meal.
Before you stop the video, it's Lori with a quick request.
If these videos are helping you cope with the news by laughing at it, I hope you consider helping me keep them going by subscribing to my Patreon. For as little as $2 a month, you get extra content and bonus goodies, as well as the satisfaction of knowing you're supporting the arts. Well, at least this artist. Thanks.
Lauren Mayer, everyone, getting us started on what day is today? It's Tuesday. Sorry, they all run together. So yesterday I had the doctor thing. Today I had to take Jackson to the doctor. He's fine. Just so you know, he's here keeping us warm in the studio as usual. Surprise today. I've got guests in the studio. You guys are only the second guests ever. Because usually, you know, people come on Zoom or whatever on the phone. I'll introduce them in a moment. Before, no audio on YouTube. No, there's audio on YouTube. I think it's just Mark. You know, I make the mistake of looking at the chat. And one person will say, no audio. And I go like, oh, my God, I got to figure. And I realize, no, everybody else has audio. So, Mark, check your settings because everyone's got audio. Okay. All right. So before we get to our guests today, a busy day so far, a busy Tuesday. It's day two of Trump Trial 1. And they seated six jurors. So apparently Trump was doing his usual, mugging, muttering under his breath, glaring at potential jurors to the point that the judge had to reprimand him. And somebody, one of the somebody on the shitter said he already hit the third rail of a trial, which is intimidating jurors. So, you know, that's going well. The judge is going to hear the argument on an application to hold Trump in criminal contempt for violating the gag order. He set the date. It'll be April 23rd. So that's just next week. And I don't know what happens. I don't know if he keeps by. It's a week from today at 9:30 in the morning. If he keeps violating the gag order, if they're cumulative, or I don't know. I guess we'll find out. Wednesdays will not be trial days from here on out. So Merchant will continue having hearings and unrelated cases, but also his time on Wednesday afternoons for motion practice or other non-jury issues in this case. Apparently, Donald wants to go to Barron's graduation. But a number of pundits have pointed out he didn't go to Ivanka's graduation, didn't go to Don Jr.'s, didn't go to Eric's, didn't go to Tiffany's, but he has to go to Barron's, right, because he's such a good father. Anyway, he also allegedly fell asleep again today, and somebody captured a photograph of the sleeping Donald in the courtroom. You guys can't see it. And for those listening on an audio stream, somebody took a Sharpie to a picture of Trump with his eyes closed in the courtroom. It says loser across his head, his forehead, and his eyebrows are bushy now, and he's got a mustache, and it says Stormy was here, and a picture of a penis pointed to his mouth. So that's about right. We go for class here. All right, so all that happened. What else? Supreme Court. Let me quickly tell you what happened in the Supreme Court today. If we have time later, we'll get back into some of this. But, I know, I saved the Associated Press because I didn't even get to hear it. But this morning, the Supreme Court heard a case dealing with one of the 1-6. Now, why can't I find it? This is what I get for having too many windows open here. I saved this. See, this is what happened. This happens to me all the time. If I had a producer, I'd have someone like keeping me in line. Where did I do? I opened up this Associated Press. I know, I'll take it from here. See, I've got four screens here and can't find what I'm looking for. Here it is. Okay, Supreme Court today questioned whether federal prosecutors went too far, in bringing obstruction charges against hundreds of participants in the January 6th Capitol riot. Associated Press goes on, it continues, it says, it wasn't clear how the justices would rule in a case that could also affect the prosecution of the former guy, who faces the same charge for his efforts to overturn his election loss in 2020. The justices heard arguments over the charge of obstruction of an official proceeding in the case of Joseph Fisher, a former Pennsylvania police officer who's now been indicted for his role in disrupting Congress's certification of Joe Biden's presidential victory in 2020. Fisher is one of 330 people facing that charge, which stems from a law passed in the aftermath of the Enron financial scandal more than two decades ago to deal with the destruction of documents. Wow, I didn't even realize that this was related to Enron at all. Trump is facing two charges in a separate case brought by, of course, Jack Smith, that could be knocked out with a favorable ruling from the extreme court. Next week, and this we're bracing for, the justices will hear arguments over whether the former guy and presumptive nominee for the 2024 Republican nomination has, quote, absolute immunity, something that doesn't exist, from prosecution in that case, a proposition that has so far been rejected by two lower courts. So The case the Supreme Court heard this morning will have ramifications one way or another on all that. Okay, so let's see. Well, Al, so we've got listener Al, Proudskell in the chat room, who lives in Alabama, and Al is very worried that there's a law that's going to pass in Alabama. And Al, you can call in, but wait a little while, because I want to introduce our guest. So if we have time later, I'll go into more other news. But that's the big stuff that happened today. Oh, did I tell you Trump fell asleep again? Yeah. Okay. All right. So let me do my magic here and try to bring up the picture with in-studio guests, because we're going to make this work. So here's what happened. Listeners know that when I'm not in here working, I am creating. I make art, or what I call art. And so I'm out in my garage, and it was about 6 weeks ago, I guess. I'm out there one day doing something, and these two people walk up to me, and you guys in the chat room will likely remember this because I told you about it. I look up, and there's two people there, a young man and a woman, who introduces herself and says she's running for school board. And of course, you know me, and I'm like, well, okay, you're running for school board, but so what do you stand for? And I think she, you know, I wasn't showing up on the voter registration rolls, so she didn't know who I was. I could have been some MAGA person hanging out. And I like to cut to the chase. I'm like, okay, so there's like Turning Point trying to take over schools, and then there's like people who are for education and facts. She's like, no, we're on the good side. We're the good people. So I spoke with Zeyna. I'm going to try. Pruzhanovsky. And I said, oh, we need to talk. I want to get you on my show. And see, this is so me. You gave me this paper with your information on it. I have the other one here. And I put it in my pocket of the shorts that I was wearing. And I proceeded that afternoon to do laundry and forgot that the paper was in my shorts. So yeah, I lost your number. But then we ran into each other at the event with
LD12, the Decadent Delights.
Decadent Delights. It's so, you know, I moved here from Florida, and in Florida, the Democratic clubs weren't as fun. So this was a gathering of people, and they had all kinds of things. Now, were you at the Jamie Raskin thing?
No.
Oh, okay. That was awesome. So anyway, we ran and we reconnected. And I was like, all right, I got to get you on the show. Fast forward to Sunday. Sunday, I'm out in the garage again doing my stuff. And two people come walking up, and there's Zeyna again. And this time she's joined by Laura Metcalfe. And so we start talking. Zeyna, again, running for the school board. Laura running for Maricopa County School Superintendent. And I'm like, okay, what are you guys doing on Tuesday? You need to come on my show, because what you're doing is so important. What's happened to our schools under this Republican cabal, and again, I moved here from Florida where it's gotten really bad, is frightening. So first of all, thank you guys for running.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Now, let's start with Laura. Laura, you're already on the school board, yes?
Yes, I serve on the school board of East Valley Institute of Technology in Mesa, Arizona.
Okay. And Zeyna, you're running for the school. You're a teacher.
Yes, I'm a teacher. I teach kindergarten, and I'm currently running as a candidate for the Chandler Unified School District Governing Board.
Okay, so now I live in Chandler. Chandler is, it's a suburb of Phoenix. It is Maricopa County, which is, by the way, ground zero for election stuff in this country. Maricopa County, the second largest voting district in the country. I didn't know. I learned something new every day. And of course, there were all kinds of, you know, problems here after the 2020 election that we're hoping are going to be fixed now. But you know, the people, the perpetrators are still up to their same tricks. So, but that's not the issue that you're about. You're here to talk about schools. Now, Arizona is, you know, Florida, we had a problem with Moms for Liberty. I know they're everywhere, but they're based there. I think the founder lived there. And I don't know if you knew, her husband was, I think, a state senator, and then they got embroiled in some kind of sex scandal, because that's what these people do. They, you know, they were having threesomes, and you can't, your kids can't read a book that may have gay characters in them, but you know, what the people do in their private time, I guess, is their business, unlike what women do with their own bodies here. Yeah. Anyway, I digress. But down here, Turning Point USA is based here. Now, Turning Point USA is a group that preys on our children, and it's all about indoctrinating them into some weird Republican cult, while they accuse us of trying to indoctrinate their kids. Like, projection is everywhere. So I'm new here, and I don't have a child in school anymore. So what is the situation here? I know around the country it's frightening that the school board seemed to be the first place of attack that the maggots tried to get in and take over. Is that what happened here too?
Yes, I'd say so. They're at the microphone at every school board that they can have an audience, and it's unconscionable. They're unraveling education in the state, district by district. So that's where I got involved. I didn't want to hear the vitriol, so I just stood up and I started speaking positive energies about what is happening in our school, how to support teachers, how to support the children, and just to dispel their negativity.
And so Laura, you sit on which school board now?
East Valley Institute of Technology.
Mm-hmm. Got it. So now you've got Maricopa County, which encompasses all these. So Zeyna, you're running for Chandler Unified School District. That and yours, and I'm guessing Tempe and Phoenix are all in the Maricopa County
correct
school system. So what is the job of superintendent that you're running for? Oversees all of it?
So this is an elected position for the county, and it is an organization that replaces school board members who step down from their seats, and it also oversees school board member or school board candidate elections and the elections for school districts when they go and override a budget or put out for a bond for buildings and improvements in their school district. So that is largely what it does. It does not regulate or oversee any of the actions or decisions of school boards in Maricopa County, and there are 58 school districts here in Maricopa County.
Wow.
But rather, it supports their efforts in the self-governance of their school districts. So with that, this office can also provide support for schools such as English language learners, with curriculum, with professional development, and things of that sort. None of those supports and services are being provided right now, but the incumbent, who is a MAGA Republican, is placing inexperienced, right-leaning, inexperienced friends from his church into school boards here in Maricopa County. Not every time, but most of the time at this point.
Now, at the meetings, are you seeing an influx of people who, one, either don't have any business being there just to disrupt, or the MAGA influence trying to push things further to the right?
Yes, both. In fact, I live in Mesa, which is one of the largest school districts in the state, and there is a concerted, structured, and rehearsed effort to try and put right-leaning individuals not only on school boards, but to speak consistently at school board meetings on issues that any issue that the school board brings up for a vote, they are rehearsed and placed there to disrupt.
You know, that's frightening to me. Again, coming from Florida, where the book banning overtook everything. I read something today that Ron DeSantis, the governor of Florida, actually, I don't know if he signed a bill. He did something today to pull back, not prohibit, I don't think, but pull back on people without children in schools flagging books to be pulled from the shelves. So to stop that from happening. Right. Well, but not enough. It got to the point in Florida where, you know, individual classrooms have their little classroom libraries. They all had to be taken down because every book had to be pre-approved before a teacher could put them in the classroom, in their own classroom library. And the people who are making the decisions to pull them are not educators. They have no, you know, in many cases, not even parents. They're just, they want their judgment to stand. And, you know, teachers, both of you guys, you have master's degrees, don't you?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
To be a teacher, you go through a lot of education. You're professional, just like a doctor. I wouldn't go to somebody who's not a doctor to take care of a medical issue. If you're teaching my children, I trust you as an educator to know what books are appropriate for each age group, not some parent or not parent just saying, there are gay people in that. They shouldn't, you know, there's a book that got pulled from the shelves in Florida. My daughter is now, she'll be 25 next month. But when she was little, do you know the O. David books? You're a kindergarten teacher, you got to know. And so David, on the front of this book, it's this little boy and he's mischievous and it's no David, everything is no David. And he's running down the street with his bare butt. He's naked. They wanted it pulled until they put clothes on David. His bare butt couldn't be on the cover of the book. I mean, it's just, it's insane.
They're illustrations.
It's not like, you know, hangy down stuff showing. It's nothing bad. It's a drawing of a little boy with a butt. But they teach our kids that the body is something to be ashamed of, that sex is dirty, that, you know, what they're doing is really harmful because they don't know the context and how to teach literature, right? So, so I'm glad you're running. Can you talk a little bit about, again, in Florida, it was the Moms for Liberty that I was mostly concerned with. Here, Charlie Kirk and Turning Point USA scares the hell out of me. Do you know enough about them to tell us how they came to be or how they amassed so much power?
Well, tend to that.
So one of the individuals that I sit with on the East Valley Institute of Technology School Board is actually backed by Turning Point USA. She is a Republican candidate for this seat, Maricopa County Superintendent of Schools. She is what they call a local representative, where she works and meets with school board members who are elected to help them go over and be able to phrase questions and point out negative side effects of policies, decisions, and other elements of a school district's decision making. So she's a coach in essence to be able to ensure that the far right opinions and actions are placed at the school board level. So when I talk about structured and rehearsed, she is one of those individuals that meets with school board members on a regular basis for that reason.
And I just want to thank you, Laura, for explaining that. What I want to tag on to that is it is a fact that with the Chandler Unified School District Governing Board race, they've handpicked three Turning Point / Moms of Liberty candidates, and that's a fact, that are going up against Reason, which is myself, and want to occupy those three seats to take over that board.
Oh, wow. Now, when you say they put them up,
they are their collective, you know, in their Republican side. They want to take over the board. There's three that have been recruited that they've been handpicked. So I have to stand against that.
Yes.
I need the voice of reason for our children, our community, standing up for teachers, and our community is important. So that's why we are running.
Right. Now, so obviously, Laura, you're already on the school board, so you've run for office before. Was that your first?
Yes, it was.
And Zeyna, have you ever run for office before?
No. This is something that we have to do. As a kindergarten teacher, a mother, a parent in the district, I just feel compelled that this is what needs to be done. I have to.
Great. See, this, I started, you know, each day I write a little write-up on the show. And what I wrote today was, have you ever thought about running for office? Now would probably be a good time to do so. Republicans have effectively taken over state legislatures, city councils, and school boards, doing great damage to our institutions along the way. And their embrace of a dictatorial conman as their presumptive presidential nominee is a mortal threat to our democracy. The stakes have never been higher, and no elected office is unimportant. The Republican Party has been really diligent about playing the long game. And they did. Look, during the Obama years, and I've got mixed feelings on the Obama years, they could have been great, but the Democrats let their guard down. And we lost state legislatures all over the country. There was no bench being built to fill these things. It's just like they lost their focus. And right now, that's all coming back to bite us in the ass. You know, people of reason need to go out and, man, they need to get on city council. They need to get into state legislatures. They need to get into school boards. If your dog catcher position is elected, you need to run for dog catcher. I mean, seriously, right? We need to get involved. And this is all hands on deck time.
And these races aren't at the school board level, at city council, they're nonpartisan. So as we are greeting people all throughout the community, as I am, I find that there are reasonable voices there. So talking to Republicans, I talk to Libertarians, Democrats, Independents. So I'm just getting the word out.
Good. No, and I was so impressed that you came, you know, you came up to my door twice. That's something, frankly, that you know, I'm a little leery of that because you don't know who's living in these houses. And it scares me. I know, look, this is an open carry state. Anybody can have a gun. That scares me. And some people are not very amenable to your message. Now, you probably noticed as you pulled up here, I have a Trump, a Biden-Harris lawn sign out front. And I was worried. We picked that up at the Jamie Raskin event. So it's been about, I don't know, about 6 weeks or so since he was here. And I put it out there and I thought, all right, how long till it's either defaced or stolen? And not only have neither of those happened, it's still there. Nobody has said anything. Not that I expected anyone to, but I thought one neighbor gave me the cold shoulder, but it must have been something else because she came by the next day with her dog and she was very friendly. So, you know, I'm pleasantly surprised. I'm still new to the area, so I don't really know the politics here. I know, you know, our park down the street over there, it says the park is sponsored or adopted by Dems Give Back. So I'm like, oh, I'm in the right area. Yeah. But, you know, I don't know the political affiliations of my neighbors. I haven't had people come up to me and go, yeah, you know, we got to make sure Trump doesn't get back in, or but the fact that they haven't taken it is I feel good about that. But the idea of going door to door kind of scares me. Is that not scary to you?
No, it's what needs to be done.
There are some interesting characters out there. There are a number of nuts that like to come out of their shells when we open the door, and some of them don't open the door to us. But for the most part, we canvass a lot together. We've never been threatened. We've had some salty information, some salty dudes we've talked to. But outside of that, really, it's what we need to do.
Yeah, I'm seeking out people so I can get the message across that I'm a reasonable person, that you should vote for me for the Chandler Unified School District Governing Board. Children are nonpartisan.
That's right.
I am a Democrat. That's my message. Mm-hmm.
Have you, I mean, do you have most people listen to what you have to say? Do they understand what's going on in school boards around the country?
They do, and they ask some of them ask some hard questions, and we're able to answer them as best we can. As a school board member, you're one of five, so you're not making that sole decision. But as a group, as a collective body, you're overseeing what the administration is doing.
Yes. A question from the chat room. My friend Spocko says, ask them if they have a social media strategy, because Turning Points USA candidates do, and it's huge.
Yes, I do. And because I have a Turning Point sponsored individual who sits with me on the EVIT school board and is running against me on the Republican side for this seat, I hired a communications person that is running all of my social media. And so far, we have done a great job with lots and lots of positive statements. And so far, it's active. It's going to ramp up here in the next month or two, just because of the getting closer to the primary.
Good. Zeyna?
And as for me, I'm positive messaging, just positive messaging, and making sure that everyone knows that schools are important, that our community is important. With a master's degree in education and undergraduate in business administration, I am fiscally responsible. That seems to be a buzzword, because we're not going to be not spending the money properly.
Yeah. The educational requirements for teachers, it's important. You're teaching our kids. I mean, what's more important? But the pay is not commensurate with the education you have and the money you spent on that education.
Correct.
How do you get people to go into teaching? I think it takes a special kind of person to do it, because they're going to make sacrifices and work hard hours and not make a lot of money.
I think too that, you know, that's a great question. I think being able to get people to come into education, when you look at it from the dollars and cents and the workload, nobody would want to do that. It's when you start working with children and fellow teachers and connecting with your community, when you see the learning that takes place and all the hard work that it went into for a child who struggles, that right there is what I've always called the shining golden moment. And I came from business and industry. I came from financial services before I became a teacher. And it wasn't until I was in my second year of teaching that I really saw that golden shining moment, and it really made it all worthwhile. And that is something you can't teach in college. It has to be experienced. And once we're able to get people to see how that works, people will want to come, and, you know, they'll do what they can with the income and the challenges that are put on to teachers, and be able to balance that plate of so many full of responsibilities. But, you know, we are making headway in that area. It's not fast enough, and it's not enough, but it's that golden shining moment when you see a student who couldn't read and now they do, or they couldn't do math and now they can. That makes it all worthwhile. And that is what attracts people to the profession. And you can't put a dollar sign on that.
No, you really can't. And I'm sure it's reward. I mean, I love kids. I always think I would do like an after school art thing, you know, and let them play like I play, because, you know, the creativity I think is important. Zeyna, so we mentioned you've got a business degree, and you've got a master's. And then Laura, you're a doctorate. You're a doctor.
Correct.
Metcalfe.
Correct.
Like Dr. Jill Biden, who also has a doctorate in education, and the right mocked her for it. What would you say to someone who she's not a doctor?
Well, I get a lot of questions about what kind of medicine I practice. That is a common question. And I do have to say that, you know, I don't practice medicine, so to speak. It is an academic degree that lends itself to running schools and school districts within school laws and, you know, policy and procedures and that kind of thing. The only thing I do joke about, though, is I do say I am trying to be the surgical removal of a fraudulent Republican who's currently the incumbent in the Maricopa County Superintendent of Schools. So I guess you could say that I have a scalpel and a piece of chalk at the same time.
Now, okay, the superintendent, I got to ask something, because this, when I first learned that this was happening here, I was mortified. Again, my first reaction was always, I'm so glad my kid is out of school. When all the stuff with DeSantis happened in Florida, thank goodness, because if she was in school, I'd be making a real pain in the ass of myself. Not that I don't anyway, but even more so. So there's this guy who's a radio guy, been doing it for years. We worked in different parts of the building in Los Angeles at the same time. I was at KLOS, the rock station. He was at KABC, Dennis Prager. Dennis Prager is just a terrible person. He holds himself out there like he's some bastion of decency, but he's a condescending asshole, pardon my language. And he's now formed something called Prager U. And he does these, and I'm doing air quotes for those not watching video, educational videos that he is now marketing to schools, to public schools. And Arizona, I think Maricopa County, has embraced them?
Yeah, the state has, actually. Tom Horn and the Department of Education here in Arizona have paid money, taxpayer money, to have a subscription for PragerU, which is, you are correct, they are far-right-leaning, conservative Republican ideals that teachers can access and tie into their curriculums and into their classrooms to be able to bring that message forward to students who know no differently and whose parents know no differently. And to be honest with you, the Department of Education and the Superintendent of Public Instruction at the state level are supposed to remain nonpartisan and not favor one type of curriculum over another. And to have this PragerU, which is not an accredited curriculum,
no,
which is not a peer-reviewed curriculum, which is not a state standards supportive curriculum. It is a far right leaning subjective, nasty curriculum. To have our taxpayer dollars spent on that not only violates the sanctity of being able to remain neutral and support state standards in this state, but we have a bias in this. And to bring that bias to the classroom and to infiltrate that with teachers and then bring that down to students and communities, that is wrong, because the idea here should be, these are pieces of information that you should choose from, and here's how you choose from them. You make your own decisions, not we tell you to make those decisions. It's wrong. It shouldn't have happened, and there's been no oversight to stop this, and that is incredibly, incredibly untenable.
I'm very few things render me speechless, but and it's hard to find these videos just out on the internet because they hide them. I guess you can get them in the schools. But I found this one. It was around Columbus Day that this one, okay, it's a very short clip, but it gives you an idea of what this is about. Here's a piece of their Columbus Day lesson from PragerU. Whoops. Ah!
Slavery. Sorry.
What? Hold on. I got to get the, I lost my window. Hold on 1 second. All right, no, there it is. Okay. Let's try this again.
Slavery is as old as time, and has taken place in every corner of the world, even amongst the people I just left. Being taken as a slave is better than being killed, no? Before you judge, you must ask yourself, what did the culture and society of the time treat as no big deal?
Again, it was probably 20 seconds. 20 seconds of real offensive stuff. Horrible.
Horrible.
And this is, so Arizona said, yes, you can put those in our public schools. Is there any recourse that...
Yes, actually, there is recourse that we can take. We can start a recall against Tom Horn. We can certainly write to Tom Horn and to our legislators and to PragerU directly and state that there is no business for any of this being available in our classrooms. Arizona has done a fine job of not providing curriculum and supports for schools. For as long as I've been around in education, they've never been allowed to say you should use this or you shouldn't use that. But then to use this and put it out there, that is crossing a line. And many times at the local level, parents don't know know what kind of curriculum is in place. And when a teacher who may be new does not know any differently, and they're like, oh, I need some material, this sounds great, and we bring it in, parents need to know, and school administrators as well as school board members need to be able to approve the use of this type of curriculum. School boards in Arizona, by law, must approve curriculum. If this is not brought to school boards on the local level and they do not approve it, that should not be available. And that is where people need to come to the school boards and understand what those school boards are approving and what they're not approving. And this crap is part of it.
Definitely. I'm glad to hear you be animated about that. It is astounding to me that is shown to our kids in classrooms. It's despicable. And knowing Dennis Prager, it gets worse. Again, I haven't seen more. I've been looking for them because we need to know. Now, when you said people should come to school board meetings, I know that the Republicans are sending people to disrupt school board meetings, all government meetings in Maricopa County. They're doing it. They're doing it in the election district. They are doing this. Are Democrats showing up?
Well, we have a group for our Chandler Unified School District Governing Board. We do have some members that come, and we try to keep a positive voice at the microphone as needed. I've been speaking at every school board meeting since May of last year. But this is important to keep the microphone free for those people that need to address the issues that need to be addressed, not to have some type of show or something that's orchestrated. So we need to keep the microphone open for the voices that need to be heard.
Right. No, I couldn't agree more. By the way, Spocko tells us PragerU is not accredited, but has become a key tool in pushing false claims to youngsters and raked in $200 million from 2018 to 2022 alone. $200 million. Oh, my God. And he says much of PragerU's early funding came from fracking billionaires, Dan and Ferris Wilkes. Two members of the Wilkes family sit on PragerU's board. Well, of course they do. Again, they're working together. Now, Republicans want to eliminate the Department of Education level.
That is correct. That's been a conversation since the late 70s, early 80s, when Ronald Reagan was president.
Wow. Again, when you decided to run, was it like a light bulb went off and you just said, I had enough of this, I got to go and step up?
It was probably in October when I had a break. So I said, I'm going to file. And that I did. But I just want to talk about the ESA vouchers and rein that in here. So that dollar that we've put on the head of every child in a classroom, it is destroying public education. So ESA vouchers.
Okay, ESA. What does ESA stand for?
Empowerment Scholarship
Accounts.
Okay. And each person that chooses to homeschool a child will receive approximately $7,500 per child of their own at home.
Cash.
So cash with a debit card that is unaccountable
so
for.
So the parents can do with that money whatever they want.
Right. So two ESA voucher children staying at home are equivalent to one Social Security recipient.
Oh my goodness.
And
per year.
To me, it is education welfare.
Now, how long is that? So Arizona has this voucher system in place. How long has that been going on?
Since 2010.
Wow, because in Florida, they just passed it. So school choice, they call it. It's not about school choice. It's about taking funding from public education and putting it either into private, often religious-based education or into the pockets of the parents who decide, I'm going to teach my kid. They don't need no stinking school. They have PragerU. And others. Yes. There are other programs like that that give them curriculums. Is there any kind of national standard for these things?
There is none. No, because the under the Constitution, the United States government, that's been written into the Constitution that the decision for education is on the states' responsibility. So there is no national no national standards for any of that. Wow. But there are accreditation organizations that accredit curriculum and schools and procedures and processes. And typically, homeschool and PragerU, organizations like PragerU and those types of things are not accredited because they don't have the structure and the leadership and the backing and the processes and systems in place to keep their curriculums relevant, valid, and useful.
Wow. You know, going through, it's a learning curve as a parent. Yeah. So I have a daughter who had issues. She had ADHD pretty bad. I had adopted her actually as a toddler from Kazakhstan. So she lived her first 18 months in an orphanage, and with it come, you know, issues. So she had some learning curves and things. And at one point, she was just a horrible student. She's very bright, but hated school. And so in middle school, you know, it was the middle school years, teenage girls, as you know, are not the easiest creatures to deal with. I actually pulled her from public school and thought, all right, I need to get her some specialized education because she's got a learning disability. She has no attention span. I know I didn't give birth to her, but we have the same affliction. Anyway, I put her in, there was a, I can't think of the name of the program. In every state, they call it something different. But it was a program where you could, if there was a private school for a reason like this, there was a scholarship. I forget what it's called, but I was allotted so much money per month that I could transfer to a private school to get her, you know, a better education for her needs. The problem is the amount they give you isn't enough to pay the tuition.
Correct.
So ostensibly, if it's to help parents, a lower income to educate their kids when they need the help, it doesn't, because you still have to go out of pocket to subsidize it. What it does do is it gives the already wealthy extra money to send their kids to parochial school, and they can afford to subsidize, it doesn't matter, but they're pulling money out of public education. A lot of people don't realize when they take attendance every day, the school gets funds based on the attendance. How many kids show up each day, right?
Correct.
So when your kids are not in the public school, the school loses out. They lose resources in terms of staff, in terms of building maintenance, in terms of books and resources. So these kind of school voucher programs that take money out of the public system are really hurting. I think it's a grand scheme to destroy public education in this country.
Exactly. We have an organization in this state called Save Our Schools, and they're a great model for the United States for those other states that are trying to crack it, you know, privatize these ESA vouchers. But for those families that are taking that ESA empowerment scholarship, they have to understand that if their child has special needs, they are waiving their rights to have their children seen in the schools. So they have to understand that with that responsibility at home, they're giving up their rights for their community education. So we have to educate the people that do need these certain scholarship accounts. There may be some, and that's how it was brought about. But as we go on, it's going up to near $1 billion in this state of funding for private education.
Right. So enough. Teachers aren't paid nearly enough, like not even in the ballpark enough. And these programs, these voucher programs, are pulling money out so that there's less money to pay qualified teachers that we need if we want an educated next generation, right? We're putting ourselves at a disadvantage on the world stage because the rest of the world is better educated now than our kids are being currently.
Correct. And one thing to think about is, you know, private schools and homeschooling certainly are a choice. And certainly now in Arizona, we have, as Zeyna called it, educational welfare. But a lot of those schools are not accredited, meaning that if I am a high school senior and I attend an unaccredited high school and I graduate with my high school diploma, my limits are, my opportunities to get into college are very limited, mm-hmm. because how does that accredit, the school needs to have that accreditation agency, which is a third party outside source saying that the education is valid and reliable and that it is worthwhile for that piece of paper, for my diploma, to be prepared to have prepared me to go to a college. Many times there are colleges that will not accept a high school diploma from an unaccredited school or organization. So therefore that child is not able to get into that school of choice if they wish, or even to qualify for federal financial aid, because it has to come from an accredited agency that the Pell Grant and other federal financial supports have to verify that the piece of paper and the education behind that paper is valid and reliable and that student is prepared to take on the rigors of college. So we are not only putting them at a disservice at the moment, but we are putting them at a disservice as an adult.
Yes. Yes. No, and I think most people don't understand what's at stake here.
They don't.
It's frightening. And then, you know, it's like every day there's something else. I don't recall if it was on 60 Minutes or maybe it was John Oliver or John Stewart or somebody who did in the last couple of weeks, I saw a piece about schools working in this like religious curriculum where it's optional, but they have the kids trying to get their friends to join in, and they do it. They can't have these programs during periods that would take away from educational, from reading, writing, arithmetic.
Correct.
So it takes up study hall time, phys ed, electives, music, if they still have that in the school. It can take those, and they take them off campus because you can't have religious stuff on campus, to an off-campus thing, and they ply them with, I don't know, parties and get, you know what I'm talking
about?
It's
called release time. And they're the Latter-day Saints or the Mormon faith here in Arizona is the pretty much the leader in that, because every child who is a member of the LDS community has a release time for 1 hour a day, every day, to go across the street to the seminary and participate in religious instruction. Again, as you're right, it has to be outside of the school building, and it has to be part of their day, but it is not interacting with their core classes, the math, the science, the reading,
right,
and things like that. So every child has a 7-hour day who's a member of the LDS faith, and they do go across the street for seminary 1 hour every day, 5 days a week.
During their day, their
Correct.
School day at a public school.
Correct, especially at public schools, and it starts in grade 7.
Oh my goodness. And they encourage the kids to proselytize to their friends. Say, oh, you got to come. It's so much fun.
Oh, yes. I was asked. I've grown up here in Arizona and in class in Mesa. I graduated from Westwood High School. I can't tell you how many times I was invited to go to seminary because it's a great time, you know? And but the problem was I didn't have release time. And so I was asked to go to seminary either during lunch or to excuse myself from a class to join, you know, Sally Sue at the seminary while she had her seminary hour across the street. And I went when I was in high school, and it was a great time. But they do. It is a marketing pyramid marketing effort.
Wow. And all the while we keep hearing them saying that those dirty Democrats, they're trying to indoctrinate our kids.
That is correct.
Projection is big in this Republican Party. That's what they know how to do. You listen to Donald Trump. Everything he says about the Democrats is exactly what he does. And this is what they're teaching our kids. This is really scary. So it's more important than ever that we have qualified educators on our school boards, dealing with what we're teaching our children. Get the just like we want. I want a doctor to confer with me about what's right for my body, not somebody with an opinion without the education or the scientific knowledge to back it up. Same thing with the teachers. I want to entrust my child's education to someone who understands why things are taught and how they're taught. You know, I look at what's happening with textbooks right now, and most textbooks come out of Texas for whatever reason. They are rewriting the history. They are taking out stories of certain historical figures and replacing with others. This is happening on a regular basis. And we, certainly as parents, have no input. Does the school board or does the school superintendent?
Well, at every curriculum change, they open, it's an open forum for discussion, and they have the a 60-day review or 30-day review, and they make that known to the public during school board meetings. So parents, families, community members, they do have options to speak up and make and read the curriculum themselves. So there are opportunities.
Good. Yeah. So it's so important. And again, my daughter will be 25 next month. Yeah. No kids coming anytime soon. That's a good thing. But my bonus son and his soon-to-be wife want children. I look at it in a very different light than I did then. Back when my kid was growing up, I sort of trusted. I'd look at her books. You know, I would go through what her homework is. I'd make sure, you know, she was learning the right thing. I got to tell you, she hated reading. She was not a reader. She's just a bad student. But at the school that I put her into for 1 year, and she went back to public school afterwards, she brought home a book one day. She's like, Mom, I found a book, like in the classroom library. She picked up a book. She's like, it's called Gifted Hands. And it's about this guy who separates conjoined twins. And it was about Ben Carson. And I'm like, oh my God, good, read it. I'm so glad you're reading. I'm like, my kid has to pick up a book about Ben Carson of all people, but good. I'm glad you're reading. Good, go read. Yes, he was a better brain surgeon than he was a politician. So, but you know, just the joy of reading, the fact that she brought home a book and was it like telling me what it was about, was a good thing. I think, you know, I was more hands-on than my parents were, because back then they didn't. Now we've got to pay attention, because there's so much mis and disinformation coming at us from all angles. And as much as they want to talk about us, you know, radical liberals trying to indoctrinate their kids, no, that's what they do, and we need to make sure they don't. So July 30th is the primary?
July 30th is the primary here in Arizona. And then November 5th is the general election. And Zeyna and I will both be on those. I will be on the July, and both of us will be on the general.
Okay, so for superintendent, you are in a primary.
Yes, I'm running against, I am the only Democrat here in Maricopa County. And there are three Republicans, two of which are very strong MAGA Republicans. And the incumbent, Steve Watson, he vacillates between being MAGA and not MAGA. But anyway, he is the individual who's responsible for having $5 to $6 million of missing taxpayer money from that office that should have gone to teachers and students, and claiming that that is only an oversight, and it isn't, because there is a forensic audit taking place.
So the superintendent is a partisan position. It's
correct.
And that's why you're on the board, but you have no other Democrats. So it's not a jungle primary. You'll be on the general election ballot.
Yes.
Okay, good. Laura Metcalfe, if you're in Maricopa County, you know who you need to vote for. And then the Republicans will fight it out for the Republican slot. Zeyna, you said it's an open.
It's open. As many as would like to collect the signatures. And the signature deadline is July 8th, I believe. So I'm still collecting signatures. And then when I turn those in, I will hope to be on that ballot, because I will have those signatures November 5th, 2024.
Wow. Okay. And until then, you're going to be campaigning and canvassing and doing what you do. To anyone out there who's thinking, maybe I should run, what do you say to them?
Well, just jump in. It's lots of fun. You meet wonderful people like Dr. Laura Metcalfe here. I met her last year in August, and I said, wow, she's a educator. I admire her. So I admire her tenacity. And you meet a lot of great people, a lot of reasonable people that have education and our community at heart.
And, you know, I often talk in song lyrics, not one of my favorite songs, but I believe that children are our future. it's a song. It's all we've got, you know. And if you let these other forces fill their heads with nonsense, we're just in deep trouble. That's all we are. So thank you both for for doing this.
Thank you.
Tomorrow on the show, there's one. I don't know if you're familiar with Rachel Bitticoffer. Rachel Bitticoffer is a political strategist. She's written books. She's brilliant. She's the one who correctly called the 2020 numbers. I mean, she got it right. Well, she sent out an email the other day pushing a new Substack by a woman named Tiffany Williams, who apparently is or was a conservative Republican. But her Substack is called Project 2025 Takedown. And it's her goal to educate everyone as to what this Project 2025 is about. And this is, you know, the maggots' plan of, I guess, world domination should they get back in the White House. It's you know, jailing their political opponents. It's fascism. It's what they're about. So tomorrow we're going to have a little deep dive into Project 2025, because it's our job to be informed and know what's going on and know what's coming down the pike if they're successful in, you know, killing our democracy. So, you know, this is a time like no other in history, or in our lifetimes anyway, certainly in history, but not in our lifetimes. Everything is on the line here, and no elected office is unimportant. Every single one deserves our energy, and if our time, if you have the money, our money, it is a battle between good and evil. I don't know any other way to put it, and I don't think that's hyperbolic. So, both of you, Laura Metcalfe and Zeyna,
Pruzhanovsky.
Pruzhanovsky. I get it right. It just takes me a couple of tries. Pruzhanovsky. Laura Metcalfe, Zeyna Pruzhanovsky. Is there a website or anywhere people can find you?
Yeah, absolutely. My website is Laura, LauraFormcss.com.
Okay.
And there's a donate button in the upper right-hand corner, and you can see all about my background and some of the platforms that I'm looking to bring to this office that are desperately needed.
Great. And Zeyna, is there a website?
Yes. Zeyna, Zeyna, for Chandler, ourcitychandler.com. And you'll also see all about me and what makes my strengths ready for this office.
Awesome. Thank you both so much for coming in, hanging with us for an hour, and for running and for stepping up, because there's nothing more important right now.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you both. Thank you. Thank you guys. I'll see you tomorrow. Get ready to learn about Project 2025. It's not going to be fun, but it'll be necessary. All right. Have a good one. Thanks for listening. Peace out.